Okay, so what is this referring to? Basically, there are two reasons given. One is that the Prophet was caught with Mary al-Qibtiyya, the slave girl, on Hafsa's day. He was sleeping with Mary al-Qibtiyya, his slave girl, on Hafsa's day, and Hafsa got very upset, and he told her not to tell anyone. She went and told Aisha. Aisha then said, this is not right, and they both nagged the Prophet until the Prophet said, okay, I'll make Maria haram for me. She's haram. And then these verses were revealed. The second reason is that the Prophet used to go and drink honey at Zainab's house. And when he went to sleep with Hafsa, Hafsa didn't like the smell. And so she told Aisha. Aisha said, let's say that he's been drinking maghafir. Have you been drinking maghafir? Because that's got a strong smell, and then he'll stop doing it. And so they went and said, oh, have you been drinking maghafir, which is a sweet thing that has a strong smell? And he said, no, but I've been drinking honey at Zainab's house, but I will make it haram for myself. It's haram now, and I won't do it. So, take your pick. But what do the tafsirs say? Okay, well, basically, most of the tafsirs give these reasons, both of those reasons. Some of them actually only give the first one about Mary al-Qibtiyya. That is the one that's the most common and most famous amongst the Mufassirin, certainly in the classical period. Nowadays, however, the reverse is true. Nowadays, people prefer the one about the honey, and in some cases, you won't even find the explanation of the Mary al-Qibtiyya. That's been kind of obliterated, and in some places, completely cut out. For example, if you look in the Tafsir of Ibn Kathir online, Ibn Kathir spends two pages, talking about the Coptic slave girl incident. If you look at the Tafsir online in English, it's not there. All these 2 pages, gone, crossed out, disappeared. You decide for yourself why. This is the Tafsir of Tabari, okay? Tafsir al-Imam Tabari, and I'm reading from it, and it says, "Qila asaba Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet slept with mamlukatahu, his slave girl, Mary al-Qibtiyya, fi bayt zawjihi, in the house of his wife, Hafsa bint Umar, the daughter of Umar, wa fi yawmiha." If you're not sure what I'm reading, here it is. فوجدته حفصة. So Hafsa found him في ذلك, in the middle of it. فغارت لذلك, and became jealous of that. فقال ألا ترضين بأن أحرمها, would you be happy if I made her haram, فلا أقربها, and don't come near her. فقالت بلى, yes, she said yes. فحرمها على نفسه, so he made her haram for himself. وقال لا تذكري ذلك لأحد, don't tell anyone that. So that's Tafsir Tabari. As I said, Tafsir Ibn Kathir, Tafsir al-Quran al-Azim Ibn Kathir, Mujarrad al-Rabi, same thing, gives the same, similar hadith, gives other hadiths, gives lots, gives two, as I say, two full pages of it. For example, he gives this one where it says, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, كانت له أمتٌ يطأها. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to have a slave girl, which he used to have sex with. فلم تزل به عائشة وحفصة حتى حرمها. And so Hafsa and Aisha didn't stop nagging him until he made her haram, and then these verses were revealed. That's Tafsir Ibn Kathir. What other tafsirs have we got here? This is Tafsir Baydawi. Okay. Tafsir Baydawi, Al-Baydawi. And يهي النبي لما تحرم ما أحل الله لك. روى أنه عليه السلام خلى بماريا. So it is related that he slept with Maria في يوم عائشة أو حفصة. There are two narrations, whether it is Aisha or Hafsa. That was Tafsir Baydawi. This is Tafsir Zamakhshari Al-Kashaf. Same thing. What have we got here? Now, the reason I'm doing all this is because the guy on the council said that it's not in any source. He couldn't find any sources for it. It's not in the tafsirs. So I'm just showing him that these are all the classical tafsirs, and it's all here in black and white. And if he can't find it, then he needs to ask himself why. Why is it that it's disappeared? أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم خلى بماريا في يوم عائشة etc. So there we are. But I'll just show you one last tafsir, which is a very interesting one, because it's called Safwat Tafasir, and it's basically a summary of all the classical tafsirs and gives an overview. This guy didn't give his own opinions, he just collected all the classical tafsirs and gave an overview of what they all say. And so it gives a good impression of what was the general opinion of the tafsirs. And the two reasons he gives, number one, as you can see, it has more space there. This is the second reason, smaller space. The first one is Mar al-Qabtiyya, and it gives the reason that and then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam kana yuqsim bayna nisa'i, he used to divide the days amongst his wives. فَلَمَّا كَانَ يَوْمْ حَفْصَةً, when it was Hafsa's day, استأذنت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, she asked for permission from Rasulullah في زيارة أبوها, to go and visit her parents. فَأَذِنَ لَهَا, so he allowed it. فَلَمَّا خَرَجَتْ, so when she went out, أَرْسَلَ إِلَى جَارَتِهِ, he sent for his slave girl, Maria al-Qabtiya, فَعَاشَرَهَا, and he slept with her, في بيت حَفْصَة, in Hafsa's house. فرجعت, so she came back, فوجدتها في بيتها, and found her in her house. فغارت غيرة شديدة, and became very jealous. وقالت أدخلتها بيتي, you entered, brought her into my house, في غيابي, while I was absent. وعاشرتها على فراشي, and slept with her on my bed, and so on. And the second reason is the شرب العسل. And what's very interesting is that he gives the overall view of what all the tafsirs and all the Mufassirin said, and he said, الرواية الأولى عند المفسرين أشهر. The first one is the most famous, the most well-known, في سبب النزول, and this is the best one, and the المرجح, the preferred one, the strongest one, and he says that it is the strongest one for many reasons, and amongst the reasons he gives are that, for example, forbidding a wife, forbidding some, forbidding a woman upon oneself to please other women is a stronger reason than forbidding honey, and that the wording of the verse with its very severe warnings and strong threats of divorce and changing the women for better women, and that God and the Prophet, sorry, God and the angels and the pious Muslims are all on the Prophet's side to help him against these people conspiring against him, and all point to something very very serious. And that there was some tenafus, some serious jealousy, competition amongst the wives, and some jealousy going on there. And all this makes the first one more likely and the second one very weak. And he even quotes Ibn Kathir, who says, كَوْنْ قَدِيَتْ شُرْبِ الْعَسَلْ سَبَبًا لِلنَّزُولِ فِيهِ نَظَرْ, that Ibn Kathir said that the case of drinking honey as a reason for the revelation of these verses is فِيهِ نَظَرْ, is questionable. Okay, well, obviously it's up to you which tafsir you prefer. I think it's interesting how many modern Muslims regard the story of Maryam al-Qabtiyya as being weak or fabricated or whatever, and yet obviously the great scholars of the past certainly didn't think so. They thought it was the best explanation. I just wonder whether modern Muslims are being influenced by modern ideas of morality. Okay, take care, bye-bye.